This is Dr. Ridwan. In this video, I will be guiding you to interpret an orthopantomogram or OPG. OPG is a two-dimensional extraoral radiograph of a three-dimensional structure, which gives a panoramic view of maxillofacial structure along with complete dentition. Because of the complexity of skeletal structure, two-dimensional radiography gives details in an overlapped manner, which makes it hard to pinpoint the pathology. So let's see how to interpret the radiograph in a simple and most effective manner. So to start with, always segment each areas and go one by one. So first, what you have to do is you have to separate this orthopantomogram into six zones. As you can see here, it can be done by drawing these four individual imaginary lines. So when you do that, what happens is it separates one structures from another so that you can concentrate at one particular area at one particular time. For example, as you can see this picture, zone 1 includes your complete dentition and zone 2 includes your maxillary sinus and nasal cavity. Zone 3 tells about the symphysis as well as the parasymphysis region. Zone 4 tells about the TMJ and its surrounding structures. Zone 5 includes the ramus as well as the angle of the mandible. Zone 6 tells about the hyoid bone as well as a part of submandibular gland region. So let's see how to interpret each and every zone separately. As you can see here, the zone 1 includes the entire dentition. That means the first thing you have to start with is check for the number of teeth. Check whether all the teeth are being present, starting from your molars till your incisors. All the tooth has to be present in all the quadrant in both the jaws. So once you confirm the number of teeth, then go for the position of the teeth. For example, check whether the canine is present exactly in between the lateral incisor and the first premolar or elsewhere. So once you confirm that, go for about the morphology of each and every particular tooth. So once you confirm these three things, then you pick each and every tooth individually and check for its findings. Usually how I start to interpret is, I'll always start with 1-8, then go towards 1-7, 1-6, then I'll finish till 2-8, then I'll come towards 3-8, then I'll finish till 4-8. So this is a pattern which I always used to follow. It is not necessary that you should follow the same pattern, but anyhow, keep one particular pattern for you so that you don't miss any tooth and any findings. So here one or two findings I'll tell you how to see. To start with 1-8, you can see there is a fractured restoration and it appears to be very deep and almost involving the pulp. So when you are talking about the individual tooth interpretation, you should check the coronal portion first. So once you find out and write the coronal portion findings, then you move on to the radicular portion. As you can see, the radicular portion appears to be normal without any periapical pathology. Now let's take 4-6 into consideration. As you can see, there is a deep fractured restoration which makes the distal pulp horn regress. And the coronal portion doesn't show any other obvious changes, and the radicular portion shows the mesial and the distal root which appears to be normal. As you can see in the periapical region, the lamina dura appears to be intact without any widening of PDL space. So once you write finding like this for each and every tooth individually, then you move on to zone 2. The most important structure in zone 2 which you have to notify is the maxillary sinus. So what I'm drawing here is the outline of the right maxillary sinus, and also we have a left maxillary sinus. So always check whether the border of the maxillary sinus appears to be intact. The corticated white thin outline should be intact. The internal structure of the maxillary sinus appears black normally. That is because it is always filled with air. In some pathological conditions, it is filled with mucus or any other fluid. Because of that, it appears white, or in otherwise it is called as opalescence. Once you note down the findings within the maxillary sinus, always check for the nasal cavity which lies medial to the maxillary sinus. As you can see here, this is the outline of the nasal cavity. Within the nasal cavity, check for the medial nasal septum. In some cases, you can see the medial nasal septum being deviated towards one side, whereas in this case, it appears to be straight without any obvious deviation. And also check for the turbinate hypertrophy. Here, you can see the left side appears to be normal, whereas the right side turbinate appears to be hypertrophied. You can also see the floor of the orbital margin on both the sides. This will be useful anatomical landmark when you're examining a patient with a facial fracture. So if at all the patient is having any fracture next to his orbit, there will be a radiolucent line or there will be a discontinuity of the orbital floor. And after clarifying the zone 2, move on to zone 3. Zone 3 gives few important structures like our mental foramen. So what you're seeing radiolucent just below the premolar on either side is a mental foramen opening. That is an important finding to observe. After that, you can see some trace of inferior alveolar canal outline on either side. So compare bilaterally whether it remains the same and compare the trabecular pattern of the entire bony structure, whether it appears normal or whether it is sclerotic or radiolucent or any other changes can be seen in any of the area. So once you identify that, just check whether the lower border of the mandible appears intact. That is a very important finding because in case of any pathology in that particular area, there will be a bowing of bone or there will be a destruction of the bony structure. So once you complete zone 3, move on to the most important area, that is our zone 4 or TMJ region. In zone 4, you can see the condylar structure. Usually the condylar structure appears to be conical or well rounded. In this case, the left side TMJ, the condylar structure appears to be rounded, whereas the right side, it appears to be more flat. That indicates in right side, there is an excessive condylar force. Because of that, that condyle is having some amount of bony changes. And also don't forget to check the articular eminence as well as the articular fossa bilaterally. Because associated with the condylar head, there will be some amount of flattening on the articular eminence or articular protuberance. And in this segment, the other important findings which you are going to see is the external auditory meatus. That black area which you are seeing is called the external auditory meatus. So after that, you can move on to zone 5. In zone 5, you will be able to see the angle of the mandible as well as the ramus region. So whenever you are checking this, always check whether it appears symmetrical bilaterally. And always see whether the inferior alveolar canal appears normal on both the sides. And this is the area sometimes you will be able to see the elongation of styloid process or a calcification of tonsillolith or parotid duct or parotid glandular calcification. So after that, the last zone which you are going to see is zone 6. This zone mainly includes our hyoid bone. And then this is also a zone which includes the submandibular gland region. So as I said before, in zone 5 and zone 6 are the one where we can expect some amount of calcification. In zone 6, we can see calcification which is happening because of thyroid cartilage that will be over here, or it can be lymph node calcification or submandibular gland calcification. So if at all the calcification is present, those things will be seen in zone 6. So this is how you separate the orthopantomogram into 6 zones and interpret in detail. So when you do like that, whenever you are interpreting a radiograph, you will never tend to miss any findings. Once you interpret each and every zone, write down all the findings separately so that once you complete the interpretation of the entire radiograph, you will have all the data about the radiograph in and out without missing any particular point. I hope you got an idea about interpreting an orthopantomogram after seeing this video. Thank you.